To understand the importance of how data is organized, let's take a look at some operations on data that you can consider as tidy and untidy for a particular task. Okay, so let's take a look at sample operations on some so-called tidy data. So we take a look at the data that we had earlier, which is the country, countries and the years 1999 and 2000, and the incidence of a certain kind of tuberculosis and the population. So let's say we want to compute the rate per 10,000 of population in each of those countries, right? So we can take table 1 and say mutate rate equals cases divided by populations times 10,000. That's what computes the rate per 10,000 of population. Okay, cases is the number of cases observed. Population is the total population, but we want it per 10,000 of population. So we multiply that by 10,000. Okay, so that's what we have here. And suppose you wanted to compute cases per year, then you can do table 1, count year, weight equals cases. Okay, that is for each year, what's the total number of cases across all the countries. So you can just count it by year. So again, that becomes pretty easy. So all of these operations are easy because the cases and population are in columns. So we are able to divide cases by population and compute the rate. We are able to mutate. And it's also easy for the second operation to compute the total number of cases in each year. That is also easy because of the fact that year is on rows and it's not on columns. Okay, so because of that, both of these operations become easy, right? So in the context of these two kinds of operations that we are performing, the first representation of the data, as in table 1, is tidy. It's a good representation. Now, suppose you want to do the same thing. Again, we are continuing. We're visualizing the changes over time, right? So we can say ggplot table 1, aesthetic year, number of cases, right? And this time we are saying geom line group equals country. In other words, we want one line per country. Okay, so we say group equals country. So it's going to take for each country, it's going to take the number of cases in 1999, the number of cases in 2000, and draw a line to depict that. Okay, so once again, and color, we just have a color for the line. Once again, and we are also doing the geom point. So once again, we find that for the kinds of operations we are trying to perform, it is nice if the year is in a column. That is, you have a column called year and you have a column called cases. Okay, and if the country is on the row. That is, you've got a column for country, but each specific country is on a particular row. So that kind of organization facilitates creating this chart very easily, right? But you can imagine other kinds of operations where these things become hard. Okay, so that's really what we are trying to say here. So now here, let's take a data set which is untidy so far as our purpose is concerned. Okay, so why do we say this is untidy? This is the second data representation that we had. Okay, and suppose with this, you want to use, you want to compute the rate, right? It's cases divided by population for every country. Okay, so first we'll have to generate this for every country. You've got the rate in each of the years. This is what we are supposed to generate. This is the output. Okay, but in order to do this, it's not very convenient, because you want to divide the number of cases by the population. But with the dplyr operations we have, it is easy to create a column based on dividing values in other columns. Now, once these things go into rows, then things become a little more complicated, right? So from this, it's not very straightforward to generate this. Okay, so you want to do this and then add it to rbind, right? Because after all, rate is yet another kind of type of value, and the value of the rate we want to put into it. So if you want to put the result into the original table, we want to create this and then add it back to the original table. Okay, so how would you create this? So if you're using table 2 to compute the rate, we're saying cases is table 2 filter type equals cases, right? So we are getting the cases for each country year combination. Okay, and then we are getting the populations as another separate table, right? So we are creating two tables, one called cases, the other called populations. And then we'll create rates as a third table by dividing. Okay, and if we want to add it back to the original, then we'll create a column called type, and within that we'll put rate. Okay, so this ends up creating what we had shown on the previous slide, and then we can then add it back. Okay, and count of course is the actual value, which is you're dividing it. Okay, so notice that the same operation that could be performed directly by using the dplyr functions on table 1 is getting very convoluted, and we have to bend ourselves in all kinds of shapes to get the same thing done on table 2. Okay, so with respect to the operations that we are now performing, table 2 is not a convenient representation. So if somebody were to give us table 2 and ask us to do those things that we are trying to do now, we would be better off using some functions to transform table 2 to the form that looks like table 1, and then use that resultant one to perform our operations. Okay, which means we have to reshape the data, right? In table 2, you've got the cases and populations sitting in one column. We would like to take that and make cases into one column and population into a separate column, and then everything becomes easy. So we'll need to reshape the data. That's really what we are trying to say here. Okay, now using tables 4A and 4B, right? These were the two tables where on the one you had the cases and the other you had the populations. Right here it becomes somewhat easier, right? So you know, table 4C, that's the new table we are creating. Table country equals table 4A dollar country, and we are trying to find out the proportions, that is the rate, and put it in a column called 1999 and in another column called 2000. So we say 1999 is table 4A of 1999, that is the cases table divided by the population table for both of these. Okay, so again, this wasn't too bad to do. Okay, that's because both those tables had a very symmetric kind of structure. We could divide one element of one table by a corresponding element of another table, and things worked out. Okay, and notice that we are using backticks here for the column names. Notice that 1999 and 2000 are really column names, because in this data set, those are in columns. In table 1, these data, 1999, 2000, the numbers actually occurred on rows. Here they occur on columns. And of course, in tables, when you have column names that are non-standard, that is, they have numbers or they have special characters, then you have to surround them with backticks. And that's what we have done here. Okay? And also, while referring to the column names, we are again using backticks. Okay? Of course, we could have said table 4A within square brackets 1, first column, second column. We could have done that, but we are just showing how you use backticks. Okay? Notice that the column name is backtick 1999 backtick. And to refer to that column by its name, we have to surround that within double quotes. Okay, so why was it easier using 4A and 4B than with table 2? Okay, that's because the two tables were pretty symmetric. Okay, so now recreate the plot showing the change in cases, this time using table 2 instead of table 1. Remember, we used table 1 and showed a plot of the change of the number of cases between the 2 years for each country. And with table 1, it was a very straightforward thing. We could just do it with ggplot. We didn't have to do any transformations. With table 2, it gets pretty difficult, because what we are trying have to do is to filter type equals cases, okay, because that's what we are interested in. And then we are saying ggplot year count, and then doing a geomline. Okay, so again, the point is to point of what I've spoken about till now is basically to think about, for the kind of operations we want to perform, how do we want the data to be ideally organized? Okay, so we've got this set of dplyr functions that are extremely powerful, that can do you know, pretty much any kind of computation we want, but all of that will work only if the data is in a form suitable for that, for those operations. If the data is not in a form suitable for those operations, it is better to first recast the data into the required form and then perform the operations, rather than bend over backwards and try to perform the operations on data which is not suitably organized. Okay? And in later lectures, we will cover functions to actually achieve this, to move data back and forth between the formats. For example, if the data is in the form of table 1, and you want it to be in the form of table 2, how to convert that, and vice versa. Okay, so now one may ask a question, well, who creates untidy data anyway? Most of the time people will be creating tidy data. Well, the point is that many times data presentation depends upon the context, right? And it's not all that easy to figure out by oneself what form of data is most suitable for a particular kind of operation, right? So for example, if we know that we are going to use dplyr, right, then it becomes possible for us to think, okay, it would be better for dplyr if the data was like this and not like that, right? But for somebody who doesn't have that kind of a background, who's just looking at giving you the data, let's say you go to someone in an organization and say, look, I want data about these things, right? Now they don't have much of an idea of how you're planning to process the data. So they are just going to give it to you in a form that they think is sensible, right? Unless you explicitly tell them, this is exactly how I want the data, they're going to give it to you in a form that they think is sensible. And from their point of view, that might be a perfectly sensible thing to do. Okay, so you will often get untidy data and you need to be able to process it. Okay, so we can't figure out ourselves. Usually somebody who's not going to do the processing may not know exactly what it is for. Another important thing is the organization of the data is dictated by many purposes, not just by how easy it is to process, because often data reports are prepared for visual inspection. Right. So for example, you may have a web page in which you want to show some data, or you may want to have a report or a printed brochure in which you want to show some data. Right. So there, the purpose is different than when you want to create data for analysis of a certain type. Right. As you want to crunch the numbers, then it may be better for the data to be in a different form. Right. So the organization of the data is not always dictated by the purposes of number crunching. It may be used for purposes of display.